This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I want to extend a warm welcome to all of you who are worshiping with us in person and also those who are worshiping online. The family of God is large and expansive and diverse, and this church has room in its heart for all of you. As you can see at the top of the bulletin, this is the second Sunday of Pentecost, and it's also the second Sunday of our grand reopening. As such, I want to take a moment to review some of the procedures we put in for our safety. Once again, you'll notice in the bullet there's no asterisks to suggesting that you stand up. Excuse me. It's requesting you to stay seated throughout the service. And also not to sing the hymns aloud and not even open a hymn book, so we don't have to sanitize them. The words are printed in your bulletin. And at the conclusion of the service, please wait to be dismissed so we can avoid a traffic jam at the doors. If you notice the announcements in the bulletin, the flowers today are presented to the glory of God in the memory of Dave Pritchard from Geraldine. There's about Amazon Smile. Every little bit helps. At the end of May, our church had earned $63 through Amazon Smile. And our family was responsible for about 1/4 of that total, and we are not big Amazon buyers. It takes a small amount of effort to get signed up the first time. Now, there are an awful lot of Presbyterian churches in the list, so it might be helpful to email Colleen first and find the exact code number, to find the exact name. But once you're signed up, it's just like ordering anything from Amazon. It's a little bit of effort at the beginning, but every little bit adds up. The angel sent Soap Pantry, see the announcement about that, taking donations on tomorrow. And again, we thank Paul and Bob for their mission in these items. Are there any other announcements we need to add? I guess I don't have to look around for the choir, do I? Okay. All right. In that case, we will proceed with our prelude. Thank you. I do have one more announcement. In case you're wondering why Dan's sitting there and Paul was sitting there last week, they're part of our representative hymn singers, and when we have a liturgist who cannot carry a tune, we need somebody else up here who does know how to sing. All right, let us continue, please, with our opening sentences from the book of Ephesians. May God strengthen us with power through his Spirit in our inner beings.
May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith.
May we be rooted and established in love.
May we have the power to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ.
Okay, please bow your heads as we continue with the joint prayer of adoration printed in your bulletin. Gracious Lord, we gather today to worship you with hearts that are often anxious and afraid. The pandemic is constantly on our minds. May our worship of you crowd out such thoughts and focus us anew on your tender love and care. In Jesus' holy name, amen. God revealed to us in the pages of Scripture is a welcoming and inclusive God who directs us to love one another. We seek to remove all the barriers that keep us from that love. Come now to confess all that separates you from others and from God. Let us pray the prayer together, the unison prayer of confession found in your bulletin, followed by a moment of silent personal confession. God in Christ, who endured the cross in your own flesh for our sakes, hear us as we confess our sin. We would be your bold disciples, but are often discouraged. We would carry our cross, but we feel like we have lead in our pockets. We count the cost of following you as long as we are having good days, but to serve you when we are discouraged is a devastating prospect. Forgive the conditions that make when we may respond to your love, and free us by your grace to find our joy in you and follow you. Amen. Jesus knows our every weakness and loves us still. Awaken to the promise of Christ's amazing love. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
If my people will humble themselves, and pray, if they seek my face and humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear. Yeah.
Our Old Testament reading comes from the third chapter of Genesis, verses 6 and 7. We find Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, making that fateful decision. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Worship this morning, and now you might be able to hear me. We miss all of our children. We miss you most especially, but during the pandemic, it's much easier for you to worship with your folks at home. But we're still doing children's sermons. Pastor Katie is starting a new series this morning for the summer. It's called Signs of the Times. And if you were here, I'm sure you could tell me what most of these signs mean. There's a stop sign, there's a crosswalk for if you have to walk across the street to your school, there's a yield sign, which means if you're at a spot, you let the other person go first, there's a railroad sign, that can be really dangerous if you get on the tracks when there's a train coming. There's a one-way sign, we have lots of one-way streets in our town. There's a handicap parking sign, a slippery when wet sign, all kinds. Pick up your trash sign, all kinds of really good rules that help us to be good citizens are found on these signs. The interesting thing about rules and regulations is that frequently the heart of them is in the Bible. And we can learn by how we do these things right. We can also participate in how God asks us to live our lives day to day. Today, we're going to be talking about traveling at your own risk. That basically means that if you see a sign that says road out, bridge out, or anything else like that, it's usually a big sign. You need to pay attention to it. You don't want to go there. So there are lots of things that we have to make choices about in our lives. Sometimes we choose the wrong thing. Most of the time, I think we do the right thing, and that's good. That's what we're trying to do while we're growing up here on earth, so that we will be ready to be citizens of heaven someday. We love you. God bless you this week, and pray that we'll be able to all be together again soon. Amen. This morning, our scripture reading comes to us from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 12th chapter, and it's just one verse. Even every one of us will give account of him or herself to God someday. The reading ends the 26th verse of the 12th chapter. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Thanks be to God. I apologize that we have to wear these things. They are not comfortable, I know. But I will take them off when I'm preaching, because if you're like me, you read lips to some extent It helps us to really hear, even with the magnification. We need that. Let us pray. Loving Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are our rock, you are our sure redeemer. Amen. This time of year, my family, when my children were young, would be preparing to go on vacation. We looked forward to that all year long. Some years we went with my in-laws to Panama City, Florida, but most years we went to Myrtle Beach. We could travel to my sister's house, camp out for a couple of days, go to the beach for 3 days, come back to her house and wash the clothes and get rid of the sand, and travel back to where our church was, anywhere in the nation. It was a fun time. It was a wonderful time just to be the four of us. And if you're a parent, you know what it is to miss those precious times. I think that one of our favorite traditions of those trips was to sit down the night before we left, the car was already packed, we were ready to go, and watch the movie Vacation. And I'm sure that I'm not the only family that had that tradition. It is hilarious. One part in the movie made me think of the warning signs that we will be studying through this sermon series, which is meant to be a fun series for the summer. Basically, if you will recall, this family of four, and add Aunt Edna in, and they're traveling through Monument Valley. And the daughter says to her dad, "Dad, I saw some signs. I think the road ends or is out." And he says, no, hon, don't worry about that. They always put big signs up when that happens." And within about 2 seconds, he runs straight into that big sign and goes airborne into the desert, crash. And the airbags deploy, and the tires are flat, and that's just the beginning of all the things that they will go through in this incredible quest to go to Wally World, would be the equivalent of Disneyland or Disney World for us. But we always watch that, and I had to think, not only did we watch it because it was funny, but I think we always had a sense that we knew there would be some things that would go wrong on the trip. And I think we figured with all the things that went wrong for them, there was no way that was all going to happen to us. So even if we had a couple of things that went wrong, it wouldn't really bother us that much. We'd still consider ourselves to be immensely blessed. In our series of road signs, we will be thinking about what the various signs are of our times, of our travel, of our lives. And basically, this first one, travel at your own risk, it talks a lot about slowing down, looking where you're going, being careful, and taking responsibility for our actions. When our family traveled, we were still, when they were little, working two for the price of one in the churches we served. And so I was in charge of the money. And I would save all year long. And before we went on the trip, I would make up all these little white envelopes. And every envelope had money in it, cash, for a particular purpose. Nice dinners while we were at the beach, fast food dinners and lunches and breakfasts when we were en route, golf for my husband, a little shopping for me, beach things, beach toys, my husband's boogie board that he always had to buy. And the wonderful thing is, we never ran out of money because the responsibility was you take it out of the envelope it belongs in and you don't get into trouble. We even had a little bit for emergency, and I had always budgeted enough to get the car washed and vacuumed out when we got home. We never, in all of those years, ran out of money. And everybody got to do the things that they wanted to do. We were responsible and we made good choices. But we don't always make good choices. Adam and Eve are our prime example today. They definitely did not make good choices. Adam and Eve were given charge to take care of the garden, to name the animals, to do wonderful things and eat of anything in the garden except one tree. It was the only rule. It would have been the only stop sign in all of Eden. And yet, being human, and we can relate, they eat of that tree. And you know the story. The serpent tempts Eve, and Eve gives the fruit to her husband too. The problem is we tend to blame other people instead of taking responsibility for our own actions. And I'm sure God, watching all of this, was just shaking his head. But basically, when Eve takes the fruit from the serpent and hands it to Adam, it's not like he's sitting at home waiting for her to come back. And he's taking it because she's such an alluring wife. Now, he's standing right next to her the whole time the serpent is talking to her. And he very willingly takes it right from her hands and takes a bite. Now, the consequence of this is they used to walk in the garden with God every evening. And it must have been almost magical to be able to walk hand in hand with God in the garden, in the cool of the evening. What an incredible time, one-on-one with the Almighty. But instead, after they ate that fruit, they soon discovered that they were naked, and then they were afraid because they had eaten from the wrong tree, and they hid from God. God goes in and he's calling for them, "Adam, where are you?" And of course he knows, but he's asking, "Where are you?" And they're hiding. And they eventually come out and God says, "Why did you do this?" "Well, the woman you gave me made me eat it." Like, and really that statement is blaming God, "the woman you gave me." And then of course Eve blames the serpent. It has become very fashionable in the world we live in to blame someone else for anything we mess up. And that is just not the way it's supposed to be. We try very hard to evade responsibility. When we've made a mistake, what is truly honorable and what God requires is that we admit it, that we say we're sorry, that we take responsibility for our action. You know, I love history, and I believe it was Harry Truman that had a plaque, sign, something like that, on his desk in the White House. And on it, it was very simple: "The buck stops here." He had a very strong understanding, both as a Christian and as a leader of the nation, that he had to take responsibility for anything that happens, even if it didn't happen to be his own action that made it happen. And that's what we try to teach our children, to always step up and be responsible. It seems to have gone out of fashion these days, but it really is still what God requires of us. Because, and the scripture makes this clear, someday we'll stand before God and we will have to account for every decision we made, everything that we said, everything we wrote, everything we did. Now that's not easy. David finds out, King David, very quickly, that he has made a very wrong decision when he has an affair with pretty Bathsheba. And when he sends her handsome husband to the front line of the battle, guaranteeing he will be killed, Nathan the prophet, he tells him, "You are the man, you're the one, you did it." And David is enough of a God-loving and God-fearing man not to stop him from having done it, but at least to take responsibility for it, to tell God that he's sorry, to literally write probably the most beautiful prayer of confession in all of scripture: "Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me." Restore to me the joy of your salvation. It doesn't get more beautiful than that. But David knew what was expected. We know what's expected. And there is actually a piece of really good news. God doesn't give us these things to make us feel bad. He gives us these things to guide us along the way we have guided our children, hoping that they will grow up to be responsible people in Christ. But the other part of this is, we're not the only ones who will stand before God. Think about the person who has done something that has hurt you the most, or someone just in the world that's done something wrong. We have to hope and pray for them. We forgive them, but we have to hope and pray that they'll live long enough to eventually ask God for forgiveness and come to God with an open heart, with the kind of prayer that David prayed. We know that our sins are forgiven. We know that when we stand before God in the last day, that Jesus will be standing next to us. And when we admit the things that we've done, when we have said that we are sorry, Jesus, when he died on the cross, died to cover all of our sins. That's the beauty of being a Christian, is our sins are forgiven. And Jesus will step forward, he will speak for each of us. But the people that don't accept that or believe that or want that in their lives, we as Christians have a duty to continue to spread the love of Jesus, the grace of Jesus, the sacrifice of Jesus, to live as Christians in this world and point to that by how we live. We really truly want them someday to be able to say, Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and I am sorry for all of my sins. Because that's really all that we know is required of us. Sometimes I think they live a little longer, so they get a chance. If you remember Jesus' parable about the laborers, even the ones that came just about the close of the day got paid the full wage. Doesn't matter when that person turns around, Jesus wants them, and he will bring them into heaven. But in the meantime, it gives us some peace to know that we don't need revenge. We don't need to do anything to anyone who has wronged us. All we really need to do is pray for them and hope that they eventually can love Jesus and accept his love for them. Now, every single day of our lives, we take risk. We travel at our own risk. And we need to be clear with ourselves that responsibility, not blaming, being willing to stand before God and say we're sorry, all of those things are integral parts of what we call the Christian life, the journey. And very much like those road trips when my children were small, we are on a journey. We will be traveling together this summer. The circumstances are a little weird this summer, but nevertheless, God walks with us. He goes with us, and he will hold up signs every now and then. I call them spirit nudges. And he will remind us of what we need to do and what we should do. And yes, sometimes we'll mess up. But we need to be fully aware that if we travel, we travel at our own risk, dependent upon the things that we do, the things that we say, the things that we write on Facebook or Twitter, the things that we live for in this life. Whatever those things are that we do, we have to be careful. We have to be willing to face the responsibility and the risk that we take. Now, there is a very popular new study I know out there for clergy. I'm sure it exists in the law. I'm sure it exists in other places where people are being trained. But I think this is actually the goal. It's called emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence, in a nutshell, is knowing when you do something, before you do it, when you're thinking about it, and before you do it, before you write about it, before you say something, you already are saying to yourself inside, how will this be perceived? How will it be received by the people that will hear it or read it or see it? Because once you figure out how your words are going to be received, it makes it a whole lot easier to be less risky in what we say and what we do. So our sign today is very clear. We travel at our own risk, but with Jesus Christ, we will be safe. We will be loved. We will be forgiven. Let us live as free and responsible people in Christ. Amen.
We have heard the word of God read, spoken, and sung. Now please join me in stating what we believe by reciting the traditional version of the Apostles' Creed printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life.
In our prayers words today, our joys and concerns. I was emailed. We need to add Danny Snyder to the prayer list. He is the brother of Kim at my office and was an old PO wrestler. Had a double lung transplant a couple of years ago and now is struggling in hospice care. So we need to pray for him and add him to our fairly lengthy list in the bulletin. Liz, is anybody typing in one? Nope? Okay. I apologize that we can't use the yellow slips, and I don't hear well enough for you to shout things out. So please, if you have someone that you want added, email me on Saturday night or text me on Saturday night. I won't leave them out. I leave the printer on all night in order to send it to the printer, even from upstairs. But we'll do it that way. Let us go to God in prayer. O gracious and loving Father, you lead us in this life step by step. You give us those holy nudges, those signs that help to steer us to the path of righteousness, to take us in the narrow way that is not always the easiest way to travel. But Lord, we trust you, we love you, and we seek to honor you with every step we take, with every word that we speak and write, and every action of our lives. Lord, today we lift up all those that are on our list of prayers, so many folks, people that have had surgery and are recovering, people that are serving and in harm's way, people that are going through chemotherapy. There are so many ways in which people hurt, and we trust them to your loving and healing care. Lord, for all the ways in which you bless us, we are thankful. Today we lift up our nation. We lift up all its inhabitants. All the people, they are all your children, Lord. We pray that this divisiveness in our nation might come to an end, that people might learn to see each other as you see them, as you see each and every person, with eyes of love, with a tenderness. May we live the words of Micah, the prophet long ago. May you help us, Lord, to do justice, to love mercy, and most especially in this time, to walk humbly with you. We pray for a vaccine, for this pandemic, and we also pray that in the midst of it, you will find ways to help us grow, to make us closer, and to give us things that only you can do, because only you can bring good and blessings out of even a pandemic. Continue to use us in a mighty and faithful way in this church, whether we're in these pews or on live worship, or when we are out in the community trying to live as your responsible ambassadors, doing what you would do as much as we can in each and every circumstance. And now, O Lord, we ask that you would hear us as we pray the way you taught us, for those times when we just don't even have the words. We have these: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Yeah. passing offering plates, but this is our normal time for bringing to God our tithes, our offerings, and most especially ourselves. We remind you that there are plates at each of the two entrances that you may use. There's also the mail slot in the manse door that faces the church. And you also can mail gifts to the church. You can use PayPal. We very soon will have a website. Tyler Good has been working faithfully on that. And it will actually have a button that will make it really easy to use PayPal. So however it is that you want to give to the church, there are many ways to make it simple and easy. But now we will bless those gifts that have come in since last Sunday. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving Father, for the ways in which you bless us, may we be a blessing. For the ways in which you can possibly use the gifts that we have, we give them with full hearts. Lord, for everything that you would have us do, we offer ourselves. We offer our time, talent, treasure, and most especially the ways that we can testify to your love over us and all we know. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To remember what it is to be God's people. We are loved and we are forgiven. Let us go this week into the world. Let us be Christ in all that we say, do, and share. And now may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon each of us and abide in our hearts, both now and forevermore. Amen.